We are fast approaching the end of the year. Looking back on the economy of Trinidad and Tobago, what is one of the first things that jumps out at you?
Troubling. I would say that the economy is in a troubling position. If one were to look at the recent UNECLAC report that was on the Trinidad and Tobago Guardian yesterday, you would see that the average growth rate for 2016 is posted at negative 4.5%. Even that, I think, is incorrect. I will give the numbers. First quarter growth for Trinidad and Tobago stood at negative 5%, second quarter growth at negative 8%. I worked out third quarter growth to be at around negative 10%. And if one were to use the average fourth quarter growth for 2015 and assumed that that would hold for 2016, you will get an overall average growth rate for 2016 of around minus 6.2%, which indicates that this is the worst contraction of the Trinidad and Tobago economy on a calendar year basis since 1983. And this is something we should be extremely concerned about, especially as in my mind, there seems to be no aggressive strategy or no major plans as to how to bail the economy out of this recession.
So with that in mind, how does the impasse on FATCA affect you or impact where we as a people need to go to try to deal with it? You speak about an aggressive strategy to deal with it.
Well, that is just one issue. I think the economy as a whole needs a holistic overhaul. Anything that increases per unit cost of transactions such as FATCA is something that we need to look at carefully. There will be other bottlenecks in the economy such as traffic, which although very different, adds to per unit cost. Port congestion adds to per unit cost. The delays in business transaction adds to per unit cost. And it is a bit discouraging. We have been talking about looking at this economy and bailing this economy out of the recession for quite a number of quarters now, and yet still we have experienced perhaps the worst contraction since 1983, and therefore we need all hands on deck and a different level and quality of planning.
Do we have all hands on deck? And I ask that question because you say even though FATCA is one issue that needs to be looked at as part of a holistic sort of process, at the same time, it is something that we have a deadline upon us. And we also have the move that banks are taking or financial institutions to say, we need to speak to you because possibly you don't get this message.
Yes, I totally agree with you in that all hands on deck are needed now. Whether or not all hands on deck are actually on deck is another matter. Certainly, opposition needs to, I understood, stand the met with the banking community yesterday or day before, and they need to approach this matter in perhaps a different way. They need to find a solution. The opposition and the government needs to sit down and find a solution that would minimize the effect of FATCA on the Trinidad and Tobago business community. But just as much also we need, again, this is just one issue, we need to also focus on things like labor productivity. We need to focus on those wave of things that we have direct control on right here. So, for example, in terms of wage increases, we have to ensure that this type of message is done in a tripartite way and the unions are very much on board and support the type of decision making that takes place. Because worker productivity is an important part of getting this economy out of the recession, and the trends in worker productivity since 2008 has not been favorable. And as a consequence, I say all hands on deck is required because there are many different sectors which need to contribute more and which are not giving as much as they could give in this particular time period. And if you would allow me, I would like to refer to the fact that there are many, many foreigners here still. And whilst we are in a recession, the magnitude of economic activity is still sufficiently large to employ the tiny labor force this economy has of around 650,000 people. And therefore, the hesitancy to reform the CPEP and other make work programs, which cost this economy around $2 billion per annum in welfare loss via underemployment costs, there is not being addressed. So it is an extremely troubling time period. We are seeing very slow movement on many fronts. No, in fact, we are seeing a high level of inaction, and therefore we need to come together as a nation and as a people to address these various matters.
Do you think within this period or within this administration's tenure, we will see an aggressive, holistic look at staggering working hours? And I say that because you've spoken about traffic and the amount of time and the cost per unit that is lost in traffic. If we have people who are reaching to work before the, or leaving their homes before the sun rises to get to work on time, doesn't it stand to reason that this is something that we can actually try to put into play in a systematic sort of way?
Yes, I think it may help, but only in some companies. The dilemma is that there are many, we have a difficulty in getting people to work. I do not know that fluctuating or modifying the working hours, perhaps later in the day or earlier in the day, would necessarily be the solution, although it would definitely help. We have a situation in which the worker ethic in this country, in my mind, was badly affected by the years of abundance and the easygoing type of laid-back lifestyle that an abundance of energy sector resources offers. So step one, I think, will be to get people to work as best as they could in the context of the existing hours. A parallel step would be to, if and where possible, in those firms where adequate policing and monitoring could be done, to change the worker hours where possible. That will not be easy, given the fact that the labor market has not shown over the years the type of dynamic to operate at full employment, at full hours employment, and therefore it will not be my first course of action, but it would be something I would consider as I move forward in improving worker ethic and in improving worker productivity.
Many economists have spoken of this period that we find ourselves in as an opportunity to refocus, see what it is really is important in terms of taking our country forward. What would you suggest are some of the things that we need to look at now and look at in a very aggressive manner?
Right. I would look at the e-tech parks and manufacturing sector in an aggressive manner. If one were to look at output, and my assumptions here and my underlying economic rationale here is very simple. If one were to take all the sectors of the economy and work out average worker productivity, one would find that apart from the petroleum sector, which is an enclave and which therefore would show very high numbers because of the high capital investment, one would find that the manufacturing sector shows higher output per worker than most other sectors in this economy. What we did in the period 2002 to 2008 in particular, when oil prices climbed from around $19 a barrel up to $147 a barrel per day in July 2017, what we did is we allowed a patronage system to develop in part where a heavy amount of employment took place in central and local government and other parts of the state machinery. As a consequence, this diversion of labor away from other main productive sectors towards sectors in which output per worker were not as high led to a structural burden effect on the economy, and as a consequence, our output as an economy became compromised. It did not look so in the numbers because of the buoyancy in production of natural gas for a period of time and because of the buoyancy in the price of natural gas and crude oil for a period of time. But after 2014, when the energy commodity price supercycle came to an end, we saw the ugly attributes of the economy. I therefore would have gone heavily after the ETEC parks, because the ETEC parks represent one type of mechanism by which we can get manufacturing jolted and pushed even further. And given that output per worker in the manufacturing sector is higher than other sectors of the economy, therefore this will release and reduce the structural burden in the economy and help to expand output faster than most other strategies, except possibly if we were able to push some export services such as medical tourism in different places. But this is the type of combined approach I would use in the short to medium term period.
Dr. Roger Hosein, thank you so much.